Moving on to front to back office. It's also part of the sort of what one would call ODD, because that's the workflow. So that's chapter 5. Here it's quite simply, you know, you're looking at how orders are inputted, how they're executed, how the workflow works. Again, no real issues here except for it was to do with shadow accounting. And I think this also goes to the issue of who's responsible for what. Obviously, if an element of responsibility has been put on the manager, they have to do shadow accounting. And sometimes they don't always do that properly or to the best ability either.
Yeah.
I don't know if you want to add anything
else.
Yeah,
a couple of points. I mean, front office workflow is often IDD. Yeah, so bear that in mind. It's not always ODD. I think it's a crucial part of ODD, because how people are getting together to make investment decisions is very, very telling about the reliability of those decisions over time. And so the perennity of an investment strategy is, in my view, highly correlated to the investment front office workflow process. The back office workflow process, we've always tended to sort of focus on, you know, who controls what in terms of the pricing and shadow accounting. Shadow accounting, you don't have to do it, but it's obviously very good to do it, and it gives you a very good idea of what you could have done wrong. And you know, this goes to the simple thing of reconciliation, shadow accounting. There's a link at the middle, back office level. You know, fat finger trade are obviously a problem of reconciliation. So I remember a manager who'd bought too much Porsche at the time because they clicked the wrong button and there was nobody else independently verifying this. It was a small manager, but nonetheless, it should be part of a process. Shadow accounting is more relevant also to the funds of funds industry, because here we're dealing with NAV, NAV procurement. Sometimes you get weekly estimates, sometimes you don't. Sometimes you wait month plus 45 days, sometimes you don't. Sometimes you've got to remember this, because this is, I think, a pertinent point. But if you have 80% of the NAVs of the underlying funds, then you got an NAV. Okay, but that's 80%, so it's not entirely true. You could still have, you know, zero for the last 20%. But these are auditors' rules, not mine, and you've got to understand them, because when things get a bit tricky, this could be useful or scary.
Also mentioned cash transfers, as you said, always look at the signatories, who's responsible for that, which part of the entity, making sure that the right entity has signed off on the cash transfers as well.
And this is very easy to do. Again, ask for faxes, spot check a fax March 2011, and you can see if it's the right people from the signatory list. Again, remember to our signatory list. And all of you who've worked in a business know that a bank will ask you for, you know, a sort of one of those fake board minutes that they write for you, and you write that you've authorized Mark and Jerome to sign, and then they'll ask for specimen signatures, so you know that Mark and Jerome will have given specimen signatures. So the verification is not very hard. It's just a matter of getting it in one of those documents you've got to see.